Hello everyone, my name is Dean Royals and welcome to our first live streaming of our I Factor finalists. So over the past 3 or 4 months we've been crowdsourcing ideas for improvement in the Trust amongst our 17,000 employees, and what we've got over the next couple of hours is the 12 highest votes that we've received for the ideas coming forward. So we're doing a little bit of an I Factor. Each of the people who have originated ideas are going to come in, they're going to pitch to us for 4 minutes, and then we've got 4 minutes of questions. We won't be introducing ourselves each time, just to save time, but all our names are on the table in front of us, and we'll be getting the participants to introduce themselves before they give their ideas. Please, if you've got any thoughts on the ideas you're hearing, then join in. Tweet us on at LTHTPeople, and Anna from the HR team will be keeping an eye on that, and we'll be trying to respond to that as we go along. But please just enjoy over the next time. It would be great to get any feedback from you. Thanks very much. Look forward to this. We've got our first participant, which I think is informatics with an idea on single sign-on. Andy, welcome.
Hello.
You've got 4 minutes. Welcome.
Thank you. My name's Andy Wiesenbaum, and I'm from informatics, and I'm here on behalf of Jackie Whittle, who submitted this idea, and that was to progress the single sign-on. It would save money on spent on doing password resets, and it probably took the most likes on the iFactor. So last year alone, there were 21,000 calls logged with the service desk to reset user's password, whether that's network or the application. And just taking the costs alone on there, the contract that we have with our service desk, that equated to £67,000 worth of people's time on service desk, just resetting passwords, and that's the contractual per hour. So that doesn't include the time the person spent frustrated trying to get into the system. It doesn't account for the time of the second or third line support technician trying to reset it, and also getting back in touch with the user. So during that time, the person didn't have access to the clinical information or non-clinical information, and so to do their day job was severely restricted. So, what does single sign-on really mean? Well, I bet everybody, if I asked around the table, people probably have a little black book and they write the username and the password in and what system it is. Or if they don't use the system very frequently, they go through and they just go through password reset process each time, and whether that's an automated or whether it's by ringing the service desk. So lots of waste through the system straight away there. If we actually put a solution in where it empowers the user to take charge of their passwords, then A, for the user, they can just deal with it themselves, just like you would your online banking, or something like that. So you try to very rarely pick the phone up and try to talk to somebody if you can't get into one of your accounts. So how do we do password resets at the moment? We have got a process. It's a bit of a disjointed one. So if you forget your network username, I'm sure you all know, you can go to a website in the Trust and reset your own password because you've put your own challenge and response questions in. Or maybe you don't know that because it's sort of a well-kept secret as well. So by bringing a single sign-on system in, you're actually bringing the solutions together that they can try signing in. And if they can't sign in, it actually guides them through the reset process, just like you'd expect on any enterprise system. So what else can we do with single sign-on? Well, we can introduce it to different technologies like our proximity door access cards or our swipe cards. We could introduce devices such as fingerprint readers. It works with a huge range of devices. But what's important is to understand what's that person trying to do at the time and what do they need access to, and how do we deliver that in a safe and secure manner. So single sign-on is not about getting rid of all passwords and just giving them a piece of plastic that they can tap on something and gain access into every single system. It's about supporting the user through the workflow so we can make sure that security is there whilst we streamline and give an easier access into it. And that might be using by PIN numbers and things like this. It could be a system that doesn't actually need a security on. It's just a way of allowing Trust users to use it and not and disallow non-Trust users, as in members of the public and things. So on our wards, we tend to have a kiosk style logging, which means that basically anybody can go up to that keyboard and get onto the internet if they wanted to. Well, introducing single sign-on gives a fast, efficient way of being able to secure that workstation but still sign in.
And you can hear the bell behind you, Andy. Give your final pitch and I will take some questions.
What do we need? We've already bought single sign-on. What we need to do is do the rollout. We need to understand what applications we use out in the business. We need some help to baseline if we want to identify the real cost of wasted money. And we want to ensure that we've got good processes around it. If people start or people leave, we can turn access on and disable access quite quickly. We do need help with the rollout to get software out onto machines and understand that. And that's where we struggle. We use our business as usual support teams at the moment. And if we do that, it means that they'll have to take their eye off the ball for the other calls that are coming in if we focus on this. So it's all down to how fast this pace of rollout. I would like it to be in 6 months' time.
Right. Well, we'll hold you there and see if there's any questions from the panel. Okay, anyone got any questions? Simon.
I was just wondering, you've talked a lot about the time saved and financial issues. How many passwords does a clinician, say an AD, have to remember, and is there any impact on clinical risk?
So there, one user could have up to 20 or 30 different passwords. They would still have 20 or 30 different passwords with single sign-on. What happens is there's a secure vault that manages it, so the system knows when you sign in with your master key, if you like, your primary key, then when you launch an application, it knows who you are, and then it can provide those credentials. So we're not taking away the security from the applications, but we're enabling that. So imagine at home you have a browser, and you can always tell it to save your password. You never know what happens when you click save your password, where it goes. This goes into our secure and robust vault. So it's that kind of concept.
Suzanne?
You've talked about 6 months. Is that 6 months to actually look at the baseline and the introduction, or is it just a baseline?
No, I would think that's the rollout. We've got the software installed today. We've got it in, we've profiled about 15 applications to prove that single sign-on works, and we've got it on about a dozen machines in informatics. So this is about going out into the business, looking at their apps and rolling. We have started working with Andy Webster in A&E as well, and we are looking to use them as sort of early adopters, but 6 months organisation-wide.
Thank you.
Andy, one thing I think that clinicians would say is that the systems time out, so the number of times a day that they have to type their password, will this do anything to that frequency?
It will, so again, it depends on how you use case each scenario and put the right security for that application that they're using. You can do a what's called a return with no password, so if you've been using it and you walked away for a minute and you came back to use it, we can set a status that you can go straight in, or we can invoke a PIN number, or we can invoke them to put their password back in. So it very much depends on what system they're trying to get, how confidential and secure that system needs to remain.
Mm-hmm. And Andrew, that was perfectly pitched, thank you. So we've got 8 minutes between 12 people today, and the idea is at the end of the day we're going to digest and cogitate and see how we can support the various initiatives. But thank you for being our guinea pig today, you're the first one in, much appreciated, and we'll let you know where we are by the end of the week.
Okay,
thank you very much, Andy. Thanks very much. And our next one we've got in is about recycling, and we've got Andrew Montgomery, who's going to present that to us, along with a colleague. You just need to get down here on the these white lines so we can get you in. There we go. So we've got four of you, five of you, if you want to quickly introduce yourselves. You've got 4 minutes, you'll hear a bell, and then I'll move you on to some questions. Is that okay? We've all got our names here. Is that okay?
So you know me, Andrew Montgomery, so I'm your lead for sustainability and environment. So I've brought together the great and the good to present the business case for recycling, and I'm going to hand over to Paul Carotto to start the presentation.
So in 2015, the Trust actually released its sustainability campaign, and from that, GRASP was actually born out. And GRASP stands for being green, recycle, aware, sustainable for our patients. And our GRASP champions actually introduced a new idea. That new idea we're talking about switching off lights, reducing waste, recycling. So I'd like to just tell you what we have to do is we aimed our sights very high because we want to be a greenest trust by 2020 in the UK, and that would give us an internationally recognised standard. But what we've achieved up to press is the fact that we've actually significantly reduced waste. We have diverted 90% of our waste from landfill. We've reduced incinerated waste by 14%. We've got a dry mix recycling program in place, and we're only one of a handful of trusts that have actually introduced a single recyclable metal items recycling facility.
So we have an established environmental champion network, and together we've made some significant improvements to the way that we manage our waste streams across the trust. And we're very thankful to Julian for his very visible commitment and support to the campaign, which has allowed us to get this far. Having achieved these successes that Paul has outlined, we've now reached a critical point in our sustainability journey. Because on the one hand, we have this overwhelming response from iFactor, which illustrates how important improving our environmental performance is to our staff. And on the other, we have a Sustainable Development Management Plan, which lays out a pathway to achieving environmental excellence. An effective environmental champion network will be the conduit getting us from where we are currently to where we aspire to be. So today, we're not going to ask you for a financial investment. Instead, we're asking you to invest in our Grass Champions' time. We would like for you to endorse for the release of Grass Champions to carry out sustainability initiatives so that the Trust can achieve the objectives that are outlined within the SDMP. We know that there are Grass Champions out there who are really keen to make a difference. They just need to be empowered. So we're asking you to help us, to help them, to help the Trust.
That's a great thing. With a short name, as you were.
I'm Libby.
Thank you.
From that, we're going to say we've told you what we like from you, and we're going to say what we can give you back. We've actually calculated the trust carbon footprint, and that's 104,000 tons. If we actually introduce the Grass Champions and use them the way we can reduce that figure by 27,000 tons, and that will give us national accreditation. Not only that, but it also gives the fact that we will be having clean air for our staff and our patients. And that's an accolade that we want to say that we are a centre of excellence. But there's a financial saving as well. £20,000 reduction with recycling on top of what we're already saving, and up to £200,000 on the energy. So that's enough from me. I'm going to hand you over to Georgia, who's going to tell you what it means to her as a Grass Champion.
And Georgia, you've just got 1 minute left in total, so...
I am one of the 451 people who showed support for recycling during the iFactor. I've been working at the Trust for nearly a year now, and I have to say, before 2 weeks ago, I didn't know what the Trust was doing for sustainability. I didn't know how or even if I could help, and I've never seen a recycling bin within my area. Becoming eco-friendly is something as a country we're becoming more aware of, but to do this within the Trust, we need the dedication and time of people who are passionate about it, and that's what the Grass Champions are. They're people passionate to make change, but to do this, they need the time to empower others, time to spread the word, and time to take a grasp on our sustainable future.
Thanks very much, Georgia. I haven't got any more to say. I know the bell going, but you're just here for questions.
Moral support.
Is that okay? Thank you, Georgia, for doing that. I know you'll be very nervous doing this, but it's great to have you coming in to do it. Any questions from our panel? Julian.
Yeah. Thank you. There we go. Question, I think, Paul, you mentioned 27,000 reduction in carbon footprint, 27,000 tonnes reduction on a baseline of 104,000 tonnes. Yeah. What would that do to our overall footprint then?
Well,
relative to others?
You know? Right, effectively that will give us accreditation at the national guidelines for our trust of our size.
Yeah.
So our carbon footprint will actually be right where it was, if you like, in its green spot. So we're not above, we'll actually be producing what's been outlined, what's been set by government for us.
Right.
Just to add to that, there are national targets that NHS is to follow. So it's best practice, and it's also ensuring that we're compliant.
And just to follow up, from the point of view of this making sense, and delighted, Georgia, you're one of the champions, that's fantastic. And you've learned a lot, obviously, in the last few weeks about what we're doing.
How well do you think other members of staff will respond to this? What's your feeling about that?
I know that within my area, since I started doing this already, people are asking what we can start doing. So within a matter of 2 weeks, we've already got 10 people that are more interested and more aware of what they can do.
Yeah.
So I think that if the word was spread a bit more around more people, then it's something that would happen.
Great.
Suzanne? Is there anything you think would look very different in a year's time?
What I would like to say is that we would be able to showcase and celebrate some of the work that's going on across the Trust so that the grass champions that are working really hard can be recognised, but also so that that good practice can be replicated across the Trust.
And I think it's not just going across the Trust either, I think people take this stuff home with them as well, so it benefits society as a whole.
Great.
And Simon, what final question?
Very excellent initiative. 451 champions, which is fantastic. You're asking for release of time.
Yeah, no, we've actually got 50 champions. We've got 451 people put the name.
Oh, okay.
So if we were looking at those 50 champions, instead of it being a team of two at the moment, and what we can do, we would actually be asking for 2 hours a month from those grass champions. It's proven that it works.
Well, that's important. So, in the big impact you're describing,
it's a small impact per time, but a big impact on your payback.
That's great. Listen, thanks very much, in particular for voting.